today, and our reading is based on the book of Matthew 28 and verse 6. Matthew 28 and verse 6. The Bible says in verse 6 of Matthew, this is the angel. It's an angel who is speaking to the women who had gone to the tomb. He is not here, for he is risen. Hallelujah. Father, I want to thank you for this word I am just about to deliver according to your instructions. Lord, I want to step aside so that you can minister this word. Let your mighty power be released. Let your anointing be released in this place. Let everyone begin to experience your touch even as I begin. I invite your presence to be here with us. It is in Jesus' name I have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. Going back to the story of the birth of Jesus Christ, there was a message that was announced by the angel Gabriel to the shepherds. And this is what the angel Gabriel said to the shepherds. Behold, I bring to you good news of great tidings. Behold, a Savior is born unto you. Behold, a Savior is born this day in the city of David. That was the announcement by the angel Gabriel. And he said, this announcement is of great tidings. It is of great joy. This is angel Gabriel at the birth of Jesus Christ. When we look at that announcement, we begin to see that that is one of the greatest announcements to this earth. Behold, a Savior is born. Truly, as angel Gabriel said, this announcement is of great tidings. It is good news. When we come to this day, the day we commemorate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, behold, we come to another great announcement, again by an angel. The angel is not named. This angel met the women as they went to the tomb of Jesus Christ in order to embalm him and to apply spices. And the angel made this powerful announcement. And I believe this is the second most powerful announcement made by an angel to the human race. And this is the announcement this angel made in verse 6. He says, Matthew 28 and verse 6, this is the announcement. He says, he is not here. He is risen. That is the second greatest announcement by an angel to humanity. This announcement about the resurrection is so vital that we need to understand why we are commemorating this day of resurrection. We are going to talk about the physical resurrection. I am not going to talk about resurrection of dead things. Today we are concerned with the physical resurrection of this body. So this message is about the bodily resurrection. The resurrection of this body when this body dies. That is the message of today. I will start by looking at very ordinary things in life. It costs a farmer a lot of labor. He has to prepare the ground and he puts in as much as possible, but he expects a result. He expects a harvest, but it costs him the labor that he puts in preparing his farm. In the same way, it costs a business person hard work, a lot of managerial planning, a lot of capital. That is the cost. But any business person will not enter into any business without a profit. There is a cost to the business person. And the cost is the labor, the planning, the capital. But there is a wonderful motive for every business person. And the motive is to make a profit or a return. And it also costs a student, like most of you have been students. It costs a student hours of study and hard work. But there is a motive. And the motive for the hard study, the hard work that you put in, is to graduate. That is the motivation. It is to graduate for better things, for a better job, for better opportunities. But there is a cost. Some of you who graduated recently, you can remember the toil. You can remember the hard work you put in. That is what it cost you. But you had a motivation. The motivation, that thing that was pushing you to study, the motivation was to make it. You wanted to graduate. That was what was motivating you. So when you look at everyday things that we do here in earth, everything we do, there is a motive. And the motive is to get the best out of what we do. But we must remember, there is always a cost. And the cost is the labor. The cost is the work we do. The cost is the hard study. The cost is the capital we put in a business. The cost is the managerial skills that we put in a business. But we anticipate a profit, a return. We expect to graduate. But looking on the spiritual side, every child of God is a disciple of Jesus Christ. There is a lot of cost involved in being a disciple of Jesus Christ. There are various types of costs we incur just by being a believer, just by being a follower of Jesus Christ, just by believing that Jesus Christ is the Savior, He is the Lord, He is the King of Kings. There are various types of costs. Just like a business person, there is a cost. Just like a student, there is a cost. Likewise, for every child of God, meaning you and me, there are costs that are involved in being a child of God. There is the cost involved in being a disciple of Jesus Christ. There is a cost involved in being a believer. Now, let's look quickly at some of the costs. Many times, as a believer, we accept to be wronged. That is what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us this: when someone strikes you on one side of the cheek, turn the other cheek also. That is the cost. There is a cost because you are expected to turn the other cheek. The word of God also says, if someone forces you to go 1 mile, you go 2 miles. It is the second mile that is a cost. It is costing you something, but that is what the Bible tells us. There is the cost that we accept when we are told, pray for your enemies. Love those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. That is the cost. We are expected to accept this. We are also told, do not revenge. Because God says, vengeance is mine. So when someone has wronged you and you want to take revenge, but you don't, because you are a follower of Jesus Christ, that is the cost. So there are many things we are commanded to accept. We are commanded to accept to be wronged. We are also expected to accept a lot of testing for our faith. Not that we have done anything wrong, but it is our faith that needs to be tested. And testing is no joke. Take the case of Job. He had not done anything. But consider what he went through. Consider that he had 10 children, they were all killed. Mm-hmm. Consider the wealth he had, it was all taken away from him. Consider what he experienced in terms of sickness. He was given a terrible skin sickness. He was reduced to nothing. Mm-hmm. Yet this man said, my God lives. Mm-hmm. I will not deny him. That is the cost this man was paying for his faith. Even for us today, we are going through tremendous trials because of our faith. Because you have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, many times your faith is being tested. Your faith is going to be tested constantly because the word of God says in 1 Peter, our faith is much more precious than gold. And you know, gold is tested with fire. But faith is more precious than gold, so it has to be tested. So we go through tremendous trials. Some of you may be going through tremendous trials right now. These trials that we experience because of our faith, that is the cost we pay. We are also expected to give up worldly pleasures for the things of the kingdom of God. While others are enjoying outside activities, we are expected to be here in the church, listening to the word of God. While others are enjoying a game, we are expected to be seated in chairs like these ones. When there is a big game that is going on, when there is some entertainment somewhere, we are expected to attend a night prayer. So we are forced to give up worldly pleasures. That is the cost we pay for being a believer. That is the cost we pay for being a disciple of Jesus Christ. We give up worldly pleasures for the things of God. We are also expected to give up our wills and submit to the will of God. In other words, God says, my will should be done in your life. Not my will, but his will. But you know, as well as I do, many times when we accept the will of God, when we submit to the will of God, the will of God may take us into areas that are very difficult, areas that are very tough. When Jesus accepted the will of God for his life, it led him to the cross. It led him to a lot of suffering. In a sense, when you are a disciple of Jesus, when you are a believer of Jesus Christ, we are expected to carry our cross every day. The cross is the cost we pay for being a disciple of Jesus Christ. So, the next question I want to ask is this. Why? Why are we giving up worldly pleasures? Why don't we go out like others to enjoy watching a game, and instead we go to a night prayer? Why are we here instead of there outside? Why are we bearing so many things just because we are believers? What is the purpose? When you look at a business person, his motivation is to make a profit. When you look at a farmer, his or her motivation is to get a good harvest. When you look at a student, the motivation is to make it for graduation. But what is your motivation? What is motivating you to bear all these things? Why would you go to a night prayer that takes hours instead of going and enjoying the world outside? Why would you choose to go to a fellowship instead of going to a hotel and enjoying yourself? There has to be a very powerful motive. The same motive that drives a farmer to keep on digging and preparing his farm, the same motive that motivates a business person to go on doing the business, in the same way, in our lives as believers, there is a very powerful motive. The motive is the resurrection. That is why we are here. That is why we bear everything. Because there is resurrection. That is why, because of resurrection, that is why we endure all the troubles we go through. That is why you endure ridicule by many people. That is why you are prepared to be put to shame because of the name of Jesus Christ. At the same time, the resurrection is the reason why we rejoice even in times of trouble. We have comfort because of the resurrection in two ways. Number one, as we sit here, we are comforted to know that a day will come when this body is buried, that this body will come alive again. So we are comforted. We are not afraid when our time comes. I told you that many people live under the fear of death. The reason is they do not know that there is the resurrection after death. But when you fully comprehend that there is resurrection after death, even when you know your time is near, you are still comfortable. We are also comforted by the resurrection because of those who have gone before us. We are assured we are going to see them again. Hallelujah. Amen. They will come back to life again. Amen. So we have a double assurance, and this is a powerful motive for us to bear all sorts of things. No wonder Job himself, he completely refused to bow under the pressure even of his wife that told him, curse this God of yours. Neither are we going to curse our God because of the fact of the resurrection. Because we know there is a motivation. The motivation is that when this life is over, I am going to come back to life again. And those who have gone ahead of us, our parents, our foreparents, those who have gone ahead, we are assured we are going to see them. Therefore, brethren, rejoice in the fact of the resurrection. We can bear so much. It is also the reason for our hope of the things to come. Remember, this life is temporary. Remember, we are drawing closer to the end of the age. And as things begin to accelerate, we are assured of one thing, that our hope rests in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He said this, because I live, you also live. Therefore, in the coming age, we hold on to this hope. We therefore again are not afraid of the future. No matter what we see, we have a strong motivation to look ahead to the hope of resurrection. Now, because resurrection is so important, there is a lot of opposition from the enemy. The enemy does not want people to talk about resurrection. There are many theories against resurrection. Even in the time of Jesus, there were still people that were saying there is no resurrection. Paul himself argued this case about people saying there is no resurrection. Today, there are people who have come up with theories that once you are dead, you are dead. That's the end. Now, if you have that kind of teaching, do you know what? You are going to live recklessly. You will not fear God at all. Because if after death, that's it, there is nothing more after death, then why should you bother with the things we bother about? Why should you suffer? Because of what you believe. If it is true that there is no resurrection. So there is a lot of opposition by the enemy. There are some false religions, and they teach some of this stuff that there is no resurrection. The same teaching was there during the time of Jesus. There is also another argument concerning resurrection. There are people who look at the resurrection and they say it is impossible. They look at this body and they say, tell me, when this body dies and it disintegrates into dust, or when the body is cremated, tell me, how is it possible that that ash, that dust, is going to come back to life again? So their argument is this: it is completely impossible. Let me tell you the good news. God says it is possible. Amen. In the book of Ezekiel, we come across the valley of dry bones. And God tells Ezekiel, look at these bones. And he asks Ezekiel, can these bones live? And Ezekiel looked at the bones and he didn't answer. He said, Lord, you know. But from the physical point of view, how can dry bones live again? But you know the story. Ezekiel was told by God, prophesy to the bones. And he prophesied to the bones. Now the bones are dry. In fact, when you read Ezekiel, the word says the bones were so dry that when he prophesied to them, there was a crackling, there was a noise. You know, when something very dry is beginning to move, there is a description of the dryness of the bones. So the bones, when they were commanded by the prophetic word of Ezekiel, they began to move together. I don't know how they found their proper place, but that is the power of God. They came together, and when they came together, something else also happened. Because God asked, those are skeletons. The bones have come together, they have formed a skeleton of a man. Where is the flesh? And God tells Ezekiel, prophesy that these bones are clothed with flesh. And Ezekiel did so. And immediately, the bones, the skeleton, they were clothed with flesh. Finally, here we have a human being, but there is no breath of life. So God turns to Ezekiel and tells him, prophesy to the wind. Prophesy to life. And tell life to come and fill up these beams. And Ezekiel did so. And the final word says, they became alive. And it was an exceedingly great army. The question we ask is, how did the bones become alive again? This is where there is this lesson that is taught, that God is able to bring alive that whatever is dead in our lives. He is able to revitalize and to resurrect everything that is dead. That comes from the valley of dry bones. Is it possible for dry bones to live again? So let me ask you, is it possible for God to solve your problem? The same power, if the same power brought bones together and they lived again. People of God, I prophesy to you like Ezekiel. Let that situation that is dead, let it become alive today in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever dream you had and it has died, let me speak the word of God into that situation and say that dream will be alive and you will accomplish that which you desire to accomplish, says the Spirit of the Lord. Even in the valley of dry bones, we have this miracle. So your miracle is today if you are willing to receive it. In the book of Psalm 139, beginning from verse 15 to 16, there is a wonderful thing about resurrection. I want to go back to a question that I asked before, because I know this question also faces you. You can begin to wonder, my dad or my mom or my child or my brother or sister who died thousands of years ago, their bodies are already dust. Tell me, Pastor, how is it possible that dust that represents my father, the dust that represents my mother, the dust that represents my child or my brother or my sister, tell me, how can it come back to life again? Hallelujah.
Amen.
What I want us to understand today is we are not talking about resurrecting a dead situation here on earth. The problems we have, that is already dealt with. We are now talking about the physical resurrection of this body. What does that mean? What is this resurrection you talk about? In order to have a resurrection, you must have the same body. You cannot call it a resurrection if it is a new body, can you? To resurrect something is to bring that thing that was dead alive, right? So the resurrection of this body means this body is going to be exactly the way it was. The only difference is this, that the body that is raised up, it is the glorified body like that of Jesus Christ. It doesn't know limitations. It can go through walls. It's not limited. But the thing is, if you talk about resurrection, it must be the bringing back to life of the same thing that was there before. That is the physical resurrection you are talking about. I want to emphasize this because people wonder, how am I going to come back to life again? And maybe I was cremated, or everything has turned into dust. How am I going to come back to life again? Go back to the valley of dry bones first. See the wonder and the power of the God we serve. But in the book of Psalm 139, 15 and 16, we have a very wonderful description of how God created us. Did you know that you and me, we were not in our mother's womb? Originally, as David puts it in Psalm 139, God looked down on the earth. And David says this, God, you saw me in the dust. You saw me in the depth of the earth. That is where we originated from. And David says, you saw my form in the dust. Not only did God see your form and my form in the dust, he also wrote down every part of you, every part of me. He wrote the dimensions. He wrote down how tall you are going to be. He wrote down how your arm is going to be. Everything about you, he wrote it down. That is what David says in Psalm 139. So, where did you originally come from? Where did I come originally from? It is not really from our mother's womb. Originally, we came from down in the earth. Because David says, you saw my form in the dust. If that is the case, if God saw my form in the dust, then after death, we return to dust. Hallelujah. After death, we go back to the original condition, the dust. So if God was able to create you and me in the beginning, is he not capable of creating the same dust again? and saying, come back to life again, and breathing the breath of life into the dust. So resurrection of this body is not a mystery. The body, when it dies, it simply goes back to the very original form it was, dust. And remember, wherever the body is, wherever the dust is, God already knows. For example, he knows this finger belongs to me. He knows that finger you are holding, it belongs to you. That is why he says, I have called you by your name. You are mine, says the Spirit of the Lord. This is Isaiah 43. So he knows everything about you. He knows about your hair. He knows what is the size of your feet. He knows the color. Everything is written down. It is all in the dust. Hallelujah. That is Psalm 139, 15, and 16. So those people who argue and say it is impossible for this body, when it has disintegrated into dust, they say it is impossible for a resurrection to take place. Behold, there is nothing impossible with God. It will simply go back to the original form, the first form we were in when God first created us. Secondly, there is a very interesting incident in Matthew chapter 27 and verse 52. This is when Jesus died. Immediately when he died, something wonderful took place. The Bible says the graves of many saints opened. And the saints who had been dead for years, their bodies came alive. And the word says they visited people in the city. You tell me then, how did God then resurrect those in the graves? They had been dead for so long, and at the time Jesus resurrected, he brings them to life again. Oh yes, the resurrection of this body is possible. Hallelujah. Amen. One issue I want to mention. There are many people who wonder, when we resurrect, because we are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and therefore our resurrection, bodily resurrection, there is a question that bothers people a lot. And the question is, will we recognize one another? Are you going to recognize your mom, your dad, your child, your brother, your sister? Are you going to recognize one another? The answer is yes. We are going to recognize one another. Why? Because it is the same body that has come back to life. It's only the body is glorified, but the features are the same. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. In the book of Luke 16 and verse 19, you know the story of the rich man and Lazarus. Both of them died. And we are told the rich man went to hell. And when he was down there in hell, he looked up. And what did he see? He recognized Lazarus. Hallelujah. Not only did he recognize Lazarus, he recognized Abraham. How did he do that? How was he able to do it? If it is Lazarus, they just died together with Lazarus. So he knew Lazarus. So he talked to Abraham and said, that is Lazarus. Could you send him to help me because I'm dying of thirst here? It is so hot here. Let him come down and dip his finger in water and cool my tongue. Can you imagine? He was not even asking for a drink of water. He was just asking, send Lazarus. Let him dip his finger in water. Let him come and cool my tongue. But I want to emphasize this. The fact is, the rich man was able to recognize Lazarus. Hallelujah. So we shall recognize one another in Jesus' name. There is also another interesting thing in the book of Isaiah chapter 14. It is about the king of Babylon. And there was a prophecy against this king. And to summarize what was said in Isaiah 14, the Bible says this, the king of Babylon was just about to die. And the Bible says this, Hell is excited of your coming. Hallelujah. Why was hell excited about the coming of the king of Babylon? And how, why were they excited? Because, number one, they still knew who king, the king of Babylon was. They could recognize him. And eventually, when the king of Babylon actually died, they begin to talk to him in hell. And they ask him, hey, wait a minute, king. Have you become like us? And he was joining other kings. So there was recognition. They recognized this guy was the king of Babylon. And they asked him, you have become as weak as we are. Every pomp you had, every fame is finished. But they were able to recognize the king of Babylon. Yes, we shall recognize one another after the resurrection. One important point. If the resurrection is the motive why we persevere, if the resurrection is the reason, it is the motive why we accept to be wronged, if the resurrection is the reason why we hold on to this faith despite the difficulties we experience, if the resurrection is the motive to hold on and to persevere when our faith is being tested, if that is the motivation, what about the people who do not believe? Are they not going to resurrect? Oh yes, they are going to resurrect. Every human being is going to resurrect. So what is the difference? Why should we as believers then bear all the sufferings? Do you remember how many people have given up their lives for the faith? Why would they give up their lives for the faith? Well, if the world is also going to resurrect, what is the difference? My brother, my sister, there is a great difference. Yes, everybody is going to resurrect. But the difference is this. Jesus said this, I am the life and the resurrection. I am the resurrection and the life. Not only is he the resurrection, he is also the life. So when you have Christ, not only are you going to resurrect, you are going to have life. Hallelujah. That is the difference. What about the ungodly? The Bible says the ungodly who die without Christ, they will never see the face of God. The Bible says, instead of life eternal with God Almighty, they will face permanent condemnation in the lake of fire. That is the destination of every human being who resurrect, but they died without Christ. This is why it is important to preach the message of salvation. And this is what a loving father was emphasizing. We must warn the world that there is final judgment that they are going to face. We must warn the world that they are going to resurrect just like believers. But if they die without Christ, there is no life for them. They will resurrect for sure. There is no question about that. But they are headed to the lake of fire. Jesus put it clearly. He said there are two ways. Choose. One is wide. It leads to damnation. The other way is narrow. It leads to life. We have to preach this message in order for people to choose which way they want to go. But at the end of it, let the world know that every human being will come to life again. But the destination is the difference. The believers, you and me, we resurrect into life eternal, but not so the believers. So this day, as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, this is what Jesus says. Behold, I stand outside. I stand outside the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and I will sit down and I will dine with that person. It is important, therefore, for every person to make sure they have opened the door of their life to Jesus Christ. If they don't open the door, Jesus cannot come in into their lives. And therefore, should they die without Christ, they will never see the face of God Almighty. This, again, is the message we need to teach everyone we meet. We must tell them, yes, there is a resurrection. Every human being will resurrect. But what is your destination? It is time to vigorously preach this message that Jesus is still standing outside the door of many people. It is time for you and me as believers to warn the people. Jesus is still there. He is still knocking. But there comes a time when the grace will be taken away. It will be harder to believe when the grace is taken away. So our mandate, our commission is to warn the people about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that it is a fact. It is our mandate and our job and our mission to preach to everyone that the tomb is empty, the grave is empty. You do not go looking for the living among the dead. He is not there. He is risen. And for those who have Christ in you, if you read a little bit ahead in Matthew 28 and verse 9, as the women were leaving the tomb and the angel had told them, behold, he is risen, he is not here. As they walked to go back to the place they were supposed to go to, Jesus meets them on the way. Guess what he said? He said in the following verse, rejoice. I tell you, child of God today, if the Lord Jesus Christ is in your life, if you are saved and you are sealed with the seal of the Holy Spirit, when you hear this word about the resurrection of Christ, begin to rejoice. Rejoice even when things are very tough, because you have something wonderful you can hold on to. You have a treasure that no one can take away from you. It is the fact of the resurrection. And Jesus said, rejoice. This is a message we need to hold on to when we are going through trials, when we are in sorrow, when our world is falling apart, when we look ahead and we don't see any hope, still the message is rejoice, because Christ conquered death. He came out of the grave, and because he rose again, we are also risen in him. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Today, as I conclude this message, it is a message that talks about the bodily resurrection. That is the main thing about the resurrection. You can talk about reviving dead situation, dead things, but that is only a part of the big thing, the big picture. Today it's about the bodily resurrection. Now you are assured. This is what the Spirit of God wanted you to know today, that should the Lord call you, should the Lord call me, should the Lord call any one of us, we should not wonder what is going to happen. We have this assurance, the hope of resurrection. He is risen. Rejoice. Whether the Lord calls you today, he calls you tomorrow, or he calls you next month, it does not matter. As long as you are established in your faith that he is risen, and because he is risen, we also live, and we are also going to rise again. Most of my ministry outside here, I deal, as I have told you before, with very sick people, dying people. One of the things that trouble them is what I'm telling you. They have no idea what to hold on to. Because they see they have only a few months remaining, but they don't know what to hold on to. I have one family, one man. Whenever I begin to talk to him, and he is about 70-something, tears begin to flow. And I asked him from the beginning, why are you crying? And he said at the beginning, I don't know what to hold on to. So I gave him this message, and he has something to hold on to now. Mm-hmm. Last time I went to see him, there was not a tear in his eyes. Mm-hmm. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
It is because he has something to hold on to. The celebration of the resurrection of Jesus is not a joke. It is no small thing. It is the second greatest announcement by an angel to this earth. It is the greatest announcement to you today and to me today. Let's carry this message to everyone. Wherever the Lord sends us, let us carry this message. Hallelujah.